Hey Turbo, how's it going, baby? You good boy? Yeah, you just started chewing on your bed and tearing it up, didn't you?
Hey, what's up, garden friends? Jeff here. How's everybody doing? Hope you're doing well. I am great. It's a beautiful day. Sun is very strong though, so the camera is still overheating like every 5 minutes. That's all right. Just finished a video on the freckles of croton. It was rough. I feel bad. Some of my videos have been really choppy lately. It's hard to film when you're interrupted every few seconds because you got a thing that runs around and chews on everything. Now, he has actually been very, very, very good lately, but still, the curious mouth. It's more about the running around and bumping into the tripod, but he's a puppy. That's what they do. I have a few things that I'd like to get done for this video, or just like today at some point, maybe over the next couple of days. I'd like to dress this area up and get it looking more colorful. Do that, well, maybe tomorrow, but for today, for right now, it's time to pull these pumpkin vines out. They don't look good anymore. There's still some fruit that's ready to pop out on them, but that heat we had about a week and a half ago, it really did a number on some of the vines. I got a few pumpkins off of them. If you watched that video, it was great. It was fun. Was one in here that I was still waiting on to ripen before I pulled it, and I had family over the weekend. I said, hey, you ever picked a pumpkin before? Go in there, and I just let them pull it and have it. And there are still some that are going to produce, and I could wait and let it grow more pumpkins, but they're just the pie pumpkins. You can get them from the grocery store for like a buck. So I don't know. I think they need to go. They're taking up a lot of space, and I'd like to be able to get to the front of these garden beds to do some more tidying and cleaning. It's just time. Typically, when I pull a vine up like this, I would just cut it back and then by hand remove whatever nubs are left. But right now I'm in more of one of those moods where I'd rather just get in, get it done, forget the clippers. I've got my big gloves on, which I know is overkill. There's some vines in here that would make more sense to pull after I get the pumpkin vine removed. But well, here we are. Oh, the little bikini teeny elephant ear growing out of there too. Wow, there's a giant pile of pumpkin seeds. This is growing like right out of the pumpkin that was thrown down in there. Whatever was left of that pumpkin, I should say. Something smells nice in here. I'm going to assume that that must be the gingers that are just above me. And there's a cord in here, so I do have to get my clippers so I can free that cord. I don't think I can pull this through. That's usually why I take the clippers and just make a cut and then remove the stubs, because otherwise just have a big old tangled mess in there. I'm pretty sure this vine was all connected in to that one. Yeah, I think it was. Found a pot from last year. It was stuck inside there. It must have been in the mulch pile from when I covered up those bananas in the wintertime. There's a slimy mess under here. That's going to be satisfying to clean up. All right, there's the first clump. Kind of, there's still some pieces in here, not a lot. I could leave this bunch because it does still have lots of flowers and some smaller fruit on it that'll ripen in a few weeks. Nah, I don't want to. I'd rather just get it out of here. I'm tired of tripping over these things and not being able to get around to the garden beds and the sprinklers and everything. I think it'll look a lot better to not have this there anymore. That feels good to have done. Finally can see the patio again. Oh, and if you were wondering, the only reason I was wearing gloves is because the squash vines have all those little prickers on them and they irritate my skin. Not really necessary, I was just kind of being a baby today. And I had the gloves, they were sitting right next to me, so I may have always used them. Oh, that looks so much better. I forgot I had my exposure turned down for the croton video. Hopefully that wasn't too dark. There's been a lot of planes flying over today. I'm just gonna talk through them, I apologize. There have been a lot of things I wanted to do, but I couldn't access the things I needed to do. Like there's the broken banana leaf in here. That's been driving me crazy. And I don't want these bikini teenies right here, these caladiums. I didn't put them here, they just spread from the other one. They're very vigorous spreaders and I don't particularly care for the way they hang out and just stick out of everything. I think it looks kind of weedy. Yeah, you know what I mean? But yeah, anyways, I'm gonna let this dry up and crust some more so I can sweep it out. Slippery and I don't really want to walk around in there. And then I'll sweep it out and then can do some pruning. There's a vine grown in there that's not supposed to be. Oh,
Oh, that feels so good to have that out of there. Love the pumpkin vine. I'll do it again next year, but a different variety. I talked about that in that video where I harvested the pumpkins. There are a few varieties that I might try that stay much, much, much smaller and won't take over that much of the patio. It was just wasn't safe the way it came out so far and left a narrow path between the pool and where you had to walk, and I was constantly pulling it back to keep it where it needed to be and pruning it. It was a pain in the butt for just pie pumpkins that you can find anywhere where I live. They sell them everywhere for a dollar, so it was just, I had the fun of being able to pick some pumpkins. It's always fun picking your own stuff, but it wasn't necessary. Makes me happy. Glad to have that out of there. I finally got a remote control for the GoPro. I've been having it set up over here, been trying to get footage of the hummingbirds. Got a few, but it took a few days. I only have one GoPro battery, and man, those batteries drain fast. Only give you like an hour. When you're filming in slow motion, it burns out even faster. Man, for some reason, I struggled getting that sentence out. This has been the best place to film them. I'm trying to set the tripod up in here on that bloom spike right there. But that one's pretty much fizzled out, and all the ones that are forward are done blooming. It does look like there's still some smaller growths coming up that will hopefully give some flowers before the season's end, but I don't know. Oh, the whole point there is that I'm also going to try and find another spot to set up the GoPro. See if I can get some more hummingbird footage. Hey, baby, getting a good drink? You good boy, Turbo. Yeah, back to the shade. It's like 84 degrees outside. It's not that bad, but the sun is very intense. I was just working on the croton video that would have come out, the video prior to this one, putting links in here to the videos that I referenced in there. And one of these videos is from 2017. And yeah, I don't rewatch my videos ever, but look at the yard. Isn't that nuts? This is the area down there underneath that Washingtonia. It looks so different. So much has changed. This is back when that berm got enough sunlight to keep bananas on it. There were so many bananas right down straight away. Right there. So there's a bunch of skip laurels there. Back in the day, that got sun. So there used to be a wall of like 10 to 12 foot tall baju bananas that lined the entire thing. And it was glorious. Oh, it was so pretty. It was a lot of work, but it was well worth the effort. And I had the Robolini palm in that spot. My old queen palm is potted, and over there, that's a palm that I had for years. It got too big for the greenhouse, the place where I store the plants, and they couldn't take it anymore. So I don't have that one anymore. That was a huge palm tree. And the last year I had it, it got put in the ground right where that is, because I figured if it's going to be the last year that I can keep it, may as well just stick it in the ground and get to enjoy it. But doesn't that look cool there with the Robolini and all those crotons underneath it? That's because back in the day, I used to buy crotons in place of like sun impatiens, because once upon a time, you could just go to a big box store and buy a 3-gallon croton for like $5 to $7. They used to give me a hard time saying that's too much money to spend on annuals. How times have changed. You know, $4.99, $6.99, that's about how much a lot of annuals cost, at least the ones from proven winners, and some of the ones that have been coming out from other growers lately. I used to be able to fill that spot with just like 4 of them. It looks so pretty. And my crinum lily, that was a crinum super Ellen that got massive. That crinum lily, I think the flower stalks on that one are supposed to be able to get up to 6 feet tall. Mine never got that big, so I only had it in the ground for about 5 years. I lost that during a bad winter, probably 2018. So it may have been the winter from 2017 into 2018. I'm not positive, and you can even see right here. I think there were skyrocket junipers. They did not like that spot. It was too wet for them. It was too wet and it was too exposed. So the way the wind would blow through in the winter time, like it kind of just comes through this patio and swoops and swirls around. Cause I live in the middle of a hill. I'm right here. There's a hill with a top up here, and then across the street, the hill keeps going down. And all these houses up here, the air just flows down and there aren't leaves on the trees, and it can sit here and swirl. And when there's a storm, it's not like the trees blow in one direction. It's just like a cyclone. It's fun to watch and also terrifying at the same time. But anyways, those junipers, they just kept getting burnt and blasted. I tried covering them. I tried spraying them. Had them around for a few years, and eventually I was just like, they gotta go. And I'm allergic to juniper. It makes my skin just break out all red and itchy, so it just made sense to get rid of them, but that was a shame. Oh, and this is it's either a black coral or one of the geckos from Brian Botanicals. I think that was a sapphire gecko. I think that's what I had there that year, because I wanted the sheen. They have like a slight blue sheen on them, and I wanted that to be visible right above that blue dune grass there. on my sago palm. I don't know if you can see that. See the sago palm? Right there? Yeah, that's gone. That I cut back to let it go dormant for winter. Sometimes in the winter with the sago palms, I'll either take them into the garage and just let them chill, give them a little bit of water every now and then, but I don't baby them because I keep them on the cool side in the garage. There's a warm side and a cool side. And then for a couple of years, I went ahead and I just dug them up, cut all the foliage off them, and just stored the stump. And that worked fine. I'd bring them back out, stick them in the ground, and within probably a month, they'd flush back out with new growth and pretty much look the same every single year. But last year, you know, with all the health stuff going on, I had people around who were helping me with everything because I couldn't do all the stuff with the surgeries. And I think it was my dad. He was doing some stuff out here for me, and he saw that big stump and thought it was just a piece of yard waste, just a log, and he threw it away. Like, it was a big log, like probably close to 30 inches. That was an old sago palm. I'd had it for a long time. But that's all right. Accidents happen. Kind of fun looking back and seeing the old yard. I have the big end set there back when the yard got enough sun to grow those without them getting all wacky and wonky. You can see some gingers that I still have are over there and some laurels. Those are still around. Oh, and I used to stick plastic ginger spikes down there into the garden. It's kind of fun rewatching old videos. Just saw a shot of Tucker. That's sad. Yeah, I don't hate how that... Oh, there goes Tucker. I don't hate how that spot looks. Like that with the Robolini instead of something big. Might have to think about that in the future. Because I love Robolini pumps. They're fun to have around. Oh, the mother and daughter croton. And that Prince of Orange. That thing's gotten huge. I still have both of those. The autumn ferns didn't make it through last winter. They started to come back and looked really great. And then we had that second blast of snow and they just went, which is stupid because autumn ferns can take all kinds of cold. I was really surprised by that. This is kind of fun. I never look at these old videos, so I don't have the reference for, you know, what's going on anymore. I don't have that anymore. I gave that one away. Look how little the croton is. It's, oh my goodness. That has done some serious growing. In fact, I don't think that's the same one. I had some that were in smaller pots, and that's probably what was over there. Oh, this is not what I was planning on doing for this video. And if it were, then I would have just recorded this and put up on the screen so you can see it better. Maybe I'll do that. I don't know. But this container, this had the variegated lady dye heliconias in them that are very hard to see. They're hard to see in the video, too. This is, I want to say 2017. I was still filming with my phone, I think. Maybe. I'm not sure. But this was my big inset morelia. That thing was massive. It was really easy to keep inside. I'd just scoot it inside into the garage in the winter and cut all the leaves off and just splash water on it, keep it cool, kept that out of active growth, and I'd bring it back out, and it would flush back out and do wonderfully. I kept it right here, right where this queen palm is, and it looked so pretty there, but eventually the trees grew enough that it was shading in the afternoon, so it wanted to grow at an angle, and I was having trouble getting a nice, sturdy, like healthy piece of growth on that plant, a healthy pseudostem on that so that the storms wouldn't blow it around, and it just kept getting knocked over and broken because it wanted to grow at an angle. So I went ahead and I gave it up. And I think that year it went into flower and I let it, and then it died. That was the only flower the one time, and then they die. Wow, there's a lot of fun stuff in this container. The Hemelia patens, couldn't find any of those this year. That was a shame because I love those. And then the, oh, what is the name of this caladium? It's some sort of dart frog, I think, that I had from Brian's Botanicals. It really wasn't ever very vigorous, so it didn't do much. Came back for a couple of years, and then I was just like, you know, it's not doing any, like I got like 3 or 4 leaves out of it, and I think I just let it go. Any other fun shots in here? I forgot that I used to have that little wobbly thing that went up and down in the videos. Oh, and the roadkill cactus. Oh, it was just a baby. Tiny little baby roadkill cactus. That was a fun plant too. All right, well, that was unexpected and unplanned. It was neat though. I thought that was kind of fun. Looking back, that was 4 years ago. How much things have changed in 4 years. Having that Robolini palm there with the crotons. That looked really good. I liked the way that looked. Now, Washingtonia, you might be staying at the greenhouse and going somewhere else next year. I might have to swap that out with a Robolini to put there. It's more manageable. And I love this palm tree. It's really cool, but you can only see it if you're down here because the bananas and everything have gotten so big that when you're down there, you can barely see it from the house. You can't really see it. And Well, it'd be cheaper to swap it out with something else. Although, look how shady this spot is, because the sun, it's that maple tree that's reached a size now where the spot, come late morning this time of year, there just isn't very much light. Up until late July, this is pretty intense and sunny, and then throughout August, it slowly gets darker and darker and darker. The plants seem okay with it, though. I just reduced the watering on it. I'm not positive how the roses are going to fare with all of that. We will have to wait and see. I'll make a decision in the fall as to whether or not those are going to be able to stay here, because if they're not going to get enough sun to keep doing their thing all the way into October, there's no reason to have them here. And I have a spot in the front yard where these would look absolutely beautiful, so we're gonna have to think on that. I wasn't sure what the sun was gonna be like here, so I didn't, yeah. It was just sort of an experiment. But like I said, though, the plants seem okay. The cannas are flowering and they're all doing well, but the flowering, I think, on the heliconias is going to start to dwindle since they're only getting light in the morning. And then there's a chunk of light that pops through here in the afternoon, and that gets pretty intense. Might be enough to keep them going, I'm not sure. But this area, this is what's really changed. With all the shrubs and everything instead of those bananas. I love those bananas. They look so good there. This looks nice too. And it's evergreen. I was so excited to get this into the ground because with those bananas, as much as I love them, from November through like mid-June, you can see right through here. And bananas, it takes a while for them to get going in the springtime. Gotta wait for the heat to kick in. So it usually wasn't until mid-June that they were maybe 5 feet tall. And then, you know, come July, they're much taller than that. But I think that this is more practical and it looks nice. I think it's a little bit more crisp, if that makes sense. There's just something about the broadleaf evergreens that seems fresh. I don't really know how to describe it. The lushness, the greenness, the fullness. Yeah, I like it. I think it's nice. Definitely not the same as the bananas, but that's okay. Oh, and now that all the pumpkins are gone, I can see my fuchsia again. This thing, I haven't been able to get to it in forever. It's been hanging out back here in the shade where the sprinklers just barely hit it. It's been keeping it fairly well watered, but you can see it's looking a little bit scraggly, but not too bad considering I really haven't been able to tend to it. Typically with the Gartenmeister fuchsias, I have to stay on top of some deadheading and really be on top of the watering, but I think this was getting just the right kind of shade for it. So it seemed like it did okay here. Didn't get a ton of growth, but it stayed in flower. It must have been pretty happy if it stayed in flower, but again, the growth, all those tiny leaves that you see on here, that's just because there's a lot of sun at one point. I doubt the light's going to be an issue for it right now because the way the angle of the sun's changed, but I don't really know. I'll keep an eye on it. It doesn't really matter now because those pumpkins are gone, so I can get in there and give that a heavy drink if it needs it. So that's good. I need to find my clippers because that broken banana leaf is driving me nuts. Okay. I just gotta figure out how am I gonna get in here. Even with the pumpkins gone, there's still a lot of stuff in the way. These elephant ears, I was talking about how I don't want them in this spot because I don't like the way they drape over the patio. They stick out too far and make the patio look smaller. And when it's like that, you can't tell that there's a curve, that there's a line that goes through here. Yes, I know I should be cutting those closer in, but I can't really get closer in just yet. It's like I have to cut my way through to be able to get in there. Oh, I don't know. Oh, you're in the way too. I don't know if I can even reach that. All right, that may have to go. Get that out of the way. That's in the way too. Get out of here. There we go. Now I can at least reach part of it. Y'all can't even see what I'm doing. There we go. That's better. He's out of here. It's like there's another broken one in here, but I'm not positive where that's coming from because I can't, well, I can't see. Can I see through the camera? Oh, there it is, right there. There we go. No, 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 no. Oh. Okay, well, that's gone forever. That's where that lives now. There's one more broken one in there. I don't know. I have no idea how I'm gonna get to that though. I got the pumpkin vines out because I just wanted to be able to get to the front of everything, but getting to the back, huh. I think I can step in there without trampling anything. So I needed to do that anyways, didn't I? Because I need to find wherever these vines start and get those pulled out. Try. Wow. Whoa, that's really in there. Okay. I'd normally say go for the root, but that did not want to come up. And there's a needle palm in there, and I don't want to tug away at that too much. So I'm going to cut that down. Hopefully there just won't be enough light in there for that to get going again. I'll keep an eye on it. Okay. All right. Come on out of there.
Ha, that's better. Is this a weed or a lantana? That's a lantana.
I think that that's, yep, that's where that's coming from. That can go. Oh, where are you? Some more pieces of vine. Those over there.
See if I can reach these.
Ow, ow. Just took a tip from the sable miner right in my ear hole. Scrub palms are pointy. There we go. Oh, that's better. I did, okay. Trampled the tradescantia a little bit, but that's okay.
Yeah, it looks better.
Kind of. Can y'all even see what's going on? The sun today. I know I've already mentioned it, but it's just awful.
You know, and actually, I feel like around September every year, I talk about the sun being terrible. This is feeling pretty deja vu-y, so maybe this is just going to be the way that it is. I don't know.
I like how this looks a lot more. When those colocasias were coming over that edge there, it just cut things off even more. With getting the pumpkins up, I wanted to open that space up and get more of a line going through everything. I think that that did the trick. The only reason I didn't pull them up by the roots was only because Turbo's out here and he's been watching me. He's asleep now. But he was watching me and I don't want him to see me pulling up plants because all monkeys see monkey do. My last dog, Tucker, never bothered with plants until one day I let him outside with me when he was right around Turbo's age. I think he's maybe a month or two older. And he was out here while I was doing a bunch of work out here, planted up a beautiful, beautiful tropical display because I was having a party that day. Lots of people coming over, like, I think it was like 50 to 70 people. I can't remember. But there was a party going on and there used to be a magnolia tree here and I had filled it with just clearance tropicals, all kinds of bromeliads, and it was stunning. But Tucker was out here while I was doing it and he didn't seem interested in what I was doing. He was off doing his thing, playing with toys. Then I went inside to wash up and came out not even 3 minutes later and he had torn up everything. Absolutely everything. And then it took a couple of months after that to teach him that he can't dig and play with the plants. I just figure it's easier to do that. Do the actual part where I reach out and pull those up by the roots when he's not watching me. I know, nobody asked, but there you go. So this space right here, I wanted to get it more colorful. I have a gorilla cart here that is just full of flowers. Isn't that gorgeous? Then come on. That, it makes me smile just looking over here. These are all just zinnias. They're in, I believe they're in 6-inch containers. Let me see here. No, they're in 8-inch containers. I picked them up from a local nursery just down the road. I grabbed 4 of those and then 2 Pachystachys lutea, which are one of my favorites. I have one. Really don't need 2 more, but I love them so much. They grow so easily. They're really easy to overwinter. I figured, why not? What a great plant to have over here. The hummingbirds love them. And they were the same price as the zinnias. They were just being sold as annuals. And they're in 8-inch pots also. They'll grow tons. Really simple, easy to grow plants. They're very rewarding. Just made sense to try and incorporate those over here into this space. And because they're so easy to overwinter, I figured, why not? It was such a good price for ones that were this size. Figured it was worth a go. Take them inside with everything else this winter. They just hang out and go dormant. And then I have 2 other plants in here that are really cool plants. We'll talk about those later. So what I want to do is get these 4 zinnias and those 2 Pachystachys lutea lollipop plants. Want to get those potted up and mixed into this area. But with the sun the way it is right now, yeah, I'm thinking maybe I'll wait until tomorrow morning when this is all shaded right here, because zinnias in the ground, they can be more drought tolerant for sure. In a container, not so much. These have to be watered like a lot. I've had these sitting here for about 2 days waiting to get them planted up, and I've watered them probably at least, I would say, maybe 6 or 7 times. That's a lot of water, which makes sense. There's a lot of energy going into making those flowers on them. So I just think it'd be a good idea to wait until early morning so they can sit in the shade and be watered in and at least have a few hours of reprieve before the sun gets on them, because within 20 minutes, it's gonna be full on blazing sun over here and it'll be like that until like 4 or 5 o'clock this afternoon. This little spot right here turns into an oven. So in the meantime, I'm going to gather up some containers. I need 4 for the zinnias and then 2 for the Pachystachys. The Pachystachys, I know I wanted one of them to go in this square ripple pot right here, but well, look at that. It's an old pot. I've had it for a long time. I have the piece in there so I can glue that back together. That's not a big deal. I love this container though.
Isn't that beautiful? These were really popular for a couple of years, and then, you know, every few years they switch up the molds that they make these things out of and the glazes. They stopped selling them, but I miss those days. That was probably circa, I don't know, maybe 2005 into 2008 or 9. And then the color started getting more bold and the shape started getting kind of more round and boring, in my opinion. But that being said, can't replace it, but I can glue it back together. Not a big deal. I have another blue pot over there. So I just need to find two more that'll be big enough for the zinnias and the Pachystachys. I'll do that and then maybe in the morning go ahead and get these potted up and spruce this spot up some more. The ladder is just here because I was changing out the drip on that hanging basket. Can't reach it without the ladder. Okay, morning. I have this much time to get that done. I was going through and editing everything from the prior clips, and the sun was nowhere near as bad on the computer as it looks through my viewfinder. So that's a relief. That's good to know. Had a storm last night. Blew the palm tree down. No big deal. Happens all the time. I have a whole bunch of pots picked out here. It turns out I'm out of Gorilla Glue. Not gonna be using that one today. That's okay. There's some in the mail. It might get here today, but who knows. But I have these to work with. I wanted to do the Pachystachys. That's these yellow ones. The lollipop plants in the square pot and then in that round pot right there. But maybe I'll just do it in these two. Now, I really want to put one in there. So I think that I'll just hold off on planting one until the glue gets here and I get that pot fixed. But all the others, I can squeeze the plants into those, no problem. Go ahead and get some potting mix into these containers. Don't need to use too much to start them off. This little white one right here, that's the only one I'm on the fence about. I feel like that might be a bit of a squeeze for those zinnias. The reason I say that is because once these zinnias reach a certain size and they're already moving into flowering, it's not a great idea to do much of anything to them that's going to disturb their roots. And see, there's really just not much of a margin to work with here, and I'm concerned that I'm not going to really be able to get enough soil in there to keep this hydrated. So maybe I'll hold off on that one for just right now and then focus on these others. Yeah, so that has a lot more space in it. Wouldn't want there to be too much space because these roots aren't likely to do a lot in the way of spreading. Now that the plant's already in flower, it's in flowering mode. It's not really so much in what's put out new roots mode. So if that gap is too big, then you have all the moisture settling outside the root ball and the plant not being able to get to it. So I want to make sure that it's just kind of in a sweet spot of like an inch to an inch and a half somewhere in there. I'd like to say that I could pull this off without making a mess, but that's not going to happen. I didn't think about grabbing the tarp. I should have done that. Ultimately, what I think it comes down to, a little bit of laziness. I like having the freedom to be able to gently tilt the plant to get the soil down around the root ball. In this, I'd have to go through and very slowly poke the soil in down there, and I don't want to do that. All right, there's Zinnia number one. Oh, and they do have a tag. This says Magellan Cherry on it, and I would say that these are clearly a mix, and it's not just Magellan Cherry, but it probably means it's the Magellan mix, which is, you know, one of the most common Zinnia mixes. That one's not looking too hot. They only had these four at the nursery, so there wasn't much to pick from. So the one does look scraggly, but I'm not really worried about it. It should be just fine. Okay, I'm liking how that's looking. I'm gonna go ahead and finish topping these all off with their soil and water them in, and then we can talk about them some more maybe. Oh, you'd be my helper? Don't eat those flowers. Don't eat those flowers, baby. Give them a sniff. I'll let you be curious, but don't put it in your mouth. There we go. That was good. Another nice thing about zinnias, don't have to worry about them hurting the dog. Hey, I think that's looking pretty good. What do we think? Quick, easy, simple. Got some more color put into the mix. That's all I was going for. Cheap. That was another big part of all this. I didn't want to spend a ton of money on annuals this time of year. At best, these will probably have, I'd say, 6 to 10 weeks left on them, and that's at the absolute max. More realistically, I would think about 5 weeks. You just never know when the frost is going to hit where I live. And usually the first frost isn't enough to kill back all of the annuals. These zinnias being here on top of pavement, they'll probably be safe from the first frost as long as it's a light one. Problem though is that sometimes our first frost, it can
like just be a random dip to like 25 degrees and be back up into the 70s and 80s the next day. You just never know. So it's pretty difficult to say how long these are going to last. They'll last long enough, and they'll even have more longevity in the sense that it's really easy to save the seeds. That was the main reason I didn't go with mums, actually. Well, that and I like zinnias more. I think they're prettier, but the nurseries, it's a lot of mums and pansies right now, and celosia, and some other really pretty plants. The nice thing, though, about the zinnias is that as these flowers age out, I could leave those there for another week or so and save the seeds and replant them next year. It's easy to do. It's cheap. In fact, I bet that those seeds look like I could dry them out and they'd be just fine, just from a flower that's maybe just a few days old. So in that regard, I consider the zinnias to be something that are going to give me more longevity. I know it's the garden mums, you can always replant them and keep them in the ground. But like I said, though, they're just not my favorites. I don't love them. I'm really particular about mums. I've done a lot of videos with little mum rants. And I like the colors here. Hoping for more of these lighter pinks, but that's okay. I think that the yellows and the whites and everything that are over here will work well. Color blend works. I don't usually do a ton of yellow, but I think it looks nice, and that's going to work well with the Pachystachys lutea that are over here. So with these, I only potted up one because, like I mentioned, the other one I need to fix the pot on before I can pot it up. With all these zinnias that are over here, I didn't do anything special. I just used the Espoma potting mix. No starter fertilizers, no compost, didn't add anything to it. That's because they're already in flower, so there's not a ton of reason to be adding much into there. If I add too much of anything, then that could really just throw them off and make them want to stop flowering and do damage to the plants. Really, the least disturbed they are, the better. So just made sure that there was a good soil around them that's going to retain some moisture and help keep them going for the next several weeks. With the Pachystachys lutea, the lollipop plant, with this one I also used the Espoma potting mix, but I put about a handful of land and sea compost in the blend as well, and I added some extra bark chips just to help it drain a little bit more quickly, and that's more for winter survival. So when I have these in the growth space during the winter time, I have to keep in mind that if these stay wet for very long, they'll rot and die, because I haven't been keeping the growth space very warm. Not last year, and I probably won't do it this year either. I'm keeping it between 50 and 75, somewhere in that area. So I don't want the soil to hold on to too much moisture, but they do like a moisture retentive soil that drains well and is organically rich. I think that that should work well because it is still going to hold on to moisture, but hopefully it won't be like a sopping wet, just like blech. That was a horrible descriptor. You know what I mean? The soil doesn't need to stay like all gross and squishy wet for an extended period of time. That Espoma potting mix holds on to moisture for pretty long. It's a good blend. I do like that mix. It has lots of organics in it. The Pachystachys are generally very easy and simple to grow. So as long as they get that water and don't get scorched in the sun, you don't really need to do too much with them. About once a year, I make sure to amend their potting mix so that it's nice and rich, but that's about it. Just don't let them dry out. They just keep growing. Oh, and I usually give them a cut back every spring because they get kind of long and leggy, and I just think they look better with the fresh chop and lots of new growth on them. And they grow very quickly too. We're kind of moving out of the warmer season, so I don't know how much growth this will put on, but it still has time to expand its roots out, time to get itself fairly established into that container before I have to move it inside. At least that's the plan anyways. Oh, so much color. Would have been nice if I could have found a couple more blue pots, but this works. Oh, I went ahead and I used the small pot. I didn't have any other options. I was looking around and at other pots that were brown, and I'm like, well, at least this way I'm maintaining a blue and white something over here, so that makes more sense. I just went ahead and very slowly poked the soil in around those roots. And these two containers, this wavy white container right here, and there's another one over there, they have the attached drainage dishes on them, so they tend to hold on to moisture for longer than I would like. Usually with pottery that has an attached drainage dish, I'll flip them over and pop another hole in the bottom so that it can drain all the way out and not sit in the decorative draining dish. That water just sits there and gets soaked back up. But it's been really dry here lately, like really dry. Even the humidity is kind of low, which is nice. It feels great. But with these, since I don't expect them to put much energy into rooting out, because why would they? They're in flower. As far as they're convinced, they've done their rooting. They're like, we don't really need to do that anymore. We're focused on the flowering. I could cut the flowers off, but I don't want to. I don't want to sacrifice any flowers when I'm only going to get a few weeks of them anyways, right? So I figured that having it in that smaller white pot was probably just fine, because it's going to go ahead and hold on to that moisture longer. Otherwise, I'm going to have to be watering it constantly. Really could go either direction on that topic, because I like a lot larger gap because it makes it easier to pot them up, more room for the roots to spread, And it's easier to water them too. Because with the zinnias, I don't really like to get much water on top of them when I'm watering. But at the same time, if there's too much of a gap, then it makes the water less accessible to the roots of the plants if they're not going to be putting those roots out. So it was just kind of a whatever. I tossed it in there. It was fine. I'm not likely going to be setting the zinnias up onto the drip, but the Pachystachys, I will. I have a drip right here that's all tangled up and I need to work it back through there. I pulled it out to get in here and then I just, you know, pieces there. I think they'll really appreciate being on the drip. The zinnias, I'm just going to watch them and wait and see how they're doing. I think that the drip might actually be too much for them because everything else that's over here are very, 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 very thirsty plants, except for the rostrata back there. And the marginata, Dracaena, not necessarily a thirsty plant, but if it's warm and you give it the water, they grow very, very, very well. You know, just because something's drought tolerant doesn't mean it has to stay that way, but the soil needs to be amended to compensate for extra moisture. Yeah, all that being said, I like how this came out. I'm liking that extra pop of color you're getting over there. It looks nice. Makes me happy. Lots of pretty flowers. In years past, I used to just set some pots up over in that spot and I'd sprinkle my zinnia seeds into them. It's too late for that. I didn't get around to it. I figured this is good. That'll do. So I do have plenty of zinnia seeds that I could have worked with. This is just, it's easier. Instant gratification. Color. I think the hummingbirds are going to appreciate it too, especially the additional Pachystachys. They love those plants. They're all over my other one. Oh, and real quick, I realized that as I was pulling those flowers off and no plants. You can have a sniff, don't you? I think he's fulfilled that curiosity, at least momentarily, with these zinnias. I didn't really show how these should be properly deadheaded, nor did I actually go about showing the seed pulling properly. So ideally, I'd be using a pair of snips, and instead of just popping the flower head off, making a cut right above the lower leaves, or even a section down below there, that this part right here, that doesn't need to stay. I just didn't have my snips on me, so I was just plucking them off. And then that one I showed for seed was just to show what the seed looked like. In order to save the seeds, excuse you, hey, Turbo, no. Don't eat the zinnias, and now there's probably a nose print on my lens. Wanna let these dry until they're nice and brown and they feel crispy and dry to touch. There shouldn't be any green or mushiness on the inside. With those ones that I pulled out, could take those and scatter them. With the ones that I pulled out and showed before how they were kind of green, see if I can pull some more out. These right here, see how they're still green? Those really aren't ready to go, but with something like this, I could take them and set them on top of a paper towel and let them dry out, and they'll probably be fine. But ideally, you want to wait for those to get nice and brown and crunchy before doing that. And so when this flower right here is ready to go, which it almost is, I'd take my snips and cut it right around there. I could cut it up there if I wanted to, but I think down there would be more appropriate. And then hold on to that, set it someplace where it's not going to be in direct sun or get any moisture on it, just let it dry out and get nice and crispy. I just plan on keeping them deadheaded. I don't know if you even need to deadhead the Magellan mix, but out of habit, I'll just do it. Just why not? It's quick and it's easy to do. And then maybe around early October to the second week of October, I'm just going to leave them and let the flowers dry out on the plants on their own because, well, it'll be time. And then when they all turn brown, I can pull them off. There's so many different types of zinnias, it's really hard to remember which ones to deadhead and which ones to not. It's when they're in containers that I like to be more thorough about making sure that any spent flowers are pulled off of the plants. And I can see I missed a few here, like this one. I'll be sure to go through and get the rest of those later when I get my snips out. For now, I think that this is good. Now, I had some potted dahlias over here, almost tripped over the hose nozzle. I went and I pulled those out. I think the zinnias look better. The dahlias, I think that I might still get a few flowers on them this season, but they're pretty much done. I mean, they need to be fertilized all the time, and I don't feel like it. I'm kind of over it. I'm more in a place of like, let me just brighten the space up and keep it low maintenance. That would be great. Yeah, you're not supposed to chew on the chair. I saw you. I saw you doing that, BB. Shouldn't be chewing on furniture, can we kiss? Thanks, BB. You so sweet. You so sweet. Good boy, Turbo. Starting to gas out for the day. Getting a little bit tired. A lot of noise going on out here. I think there's three different lawns that are getting mowed right now. So I'm glad to have this done. I think that looks nice. Look even better without the gate in front of it and the hose and everything. I'm liking the color. Pollinators should enjoy it. It's nice having. It's so nice having the patio cleaned up over there, but I forgot I moved the ladder over there to get out of the way from this shot right here, and I scooted it over there. I'm debating taking that basket down and redoing it because
it's starting to bother me, even though I know that if I just wait a few more weeks and the cooler evenings start to set in, everything in that basket's going to flush back out and start to look beautiful again. I'm trying to make up my mind here as to whether or not to be patient and just wait for that to flush back out. I do need to add some amendment in there. I'll probably throw a couple of handfuls of compost and some fertilizer in there because it needs to be livened back up. The soil needs to be livened back up, that is. But it's just everything else is looking so pretty and colorful. It's that time of year where everything's in its prime, except for the gingers because they did all their flowering at the same time this year instead of in succession. But that's okay. I should have expected that because those got divided last year. So that's pretty normal for the year after a heavy division. And they still have some stuff coming up that will flower. Yeah, all that's neither here nor there. The zinnias are going to be getting plenty of sun here from about mid to late morning all the way into, say, like 4 o'clock in the afternoon. And it's on top of hot pavement here. So I'll have to keep an eye on them, make sure they don't scorch. Same thing with the Pachystachys, those lollipop plants. I've kept those in the spot on multiple occasions. They've always done wonderfully as long as they're tucked back and they're far enough so that they get a little bit of safety from the afternoon sun. Oh, I'm not too worried about those. Anyways, this is nice. Clean patio, got some stuff on it. There's projects going on, but that's all right. Dogs have been good. It's a beautiful day. And I think that's going to do it. Yeah, it was a nice week. Hope y'all are doing well. Comment down below. Say hi. Love talking to everybody. Tips, tricks, suggestions. Always appreciated, especially when it comes to keeping things like dahlias and zinnias in pots. And generally, the culture and care is going to be different when they're in containers versus in the ground. I tend to use a more moisture-retentive soil in a pot than I would want if they're in the ground. And I water them more heavily when they're in a pot than in the ground because those dry out more quickly. I think we already talked about all that, right? Yeah, I believe so. And I'm more on top of deadheading, too. Definitely talked about that. Oh, I almost forgot. There were a couple other plants that I grabbed when I was at the nursery. And I was going to show them to you. There's not a ton to say about them. They're just neat plants. Look at this. Isn't that beautiful? It's kind of scraggly looking, but it's nice. There's a lot to say about it. I won't squeeze it all into this video. We'll talk more about it another time. This is a clethra. It's a barbinervis. Takeda nishiki is the variety. An excellent shade plant. Clethras. Talked about them before, particularly when I was talking about those ruby spice clethras. Going to like having that pop of white in the shade. It will help lighten up the darker spots in the garden. Then this, that doesn't want to focus, this is a wisteria. Look at how small and dainty the leaves are on this wisteria. I absolutely love it. This is one for bonsai. It's a sinensis kofuji. Kofuji? Sinensis kofuji. I don't know. Y'all tell me how to say it. Traditionally, a very popular variety of wisteria to use for bonsai. Not one that flowers all that heavily, but that's okay. I'm not crazy about where the cut is on it, but I've never been able to find these for sale locally before. Oops, not gonna work it over. So it's okay, I'm fine with it. I will probably actually be putting this in the ground for a few years to get it more thickened up. It's a lot easier than doing it while they're in a bonsai pot or in a root training pot, just to put them in the ground for a few years, get them thickened up that way, and then dig them, move them into a root training pot, and then start to bonsai with them. But I'm going to want to get some new leaves out from underneath this one because I don't like this spot right here. I could make it work, but I'm not crazy about it. And since I would probably want to go with this in the ground for a few years anyways, then it doesn't matter. Some fun new plants. They're pretty. Like I said, hope everybody's doing well, having a great day and a great life, and everything's just going beautifully for you. I know myself well enough to just stop while I'm ahead. I could have just gone on to a whole entire ramble that isn't necessary, at least not in this video. And of course, as always, and most importantly, everybody, keep on growing. Bye-bye.